This year, over the years, I've developed business partnerships with people who are at the center of import and export work. And by the nature of Israel being such a small country and everybody kind of knows everybody else, I can get to any business I want to get to. I call in one of my associates, he'll call someone who knows someone, and in a day or two, that relationship is made. Because you have to understand that the smallness of Israel causes it to do business in a different way than larger countries. And finally, be patient. Use your good judgment and do not rush into choices. In the seminar I'm now taking, someone referred to a recent survey requesting Chinese businessmen and Western businessmen. I said, who has a choice between a bad decision or no decision? Which would you choose? The majority of Western businessmen said, bad decision. The majority of Chinese said, no decision. My advice to you, no decision. Take your time. Take your time. One last point on that. Even from some of the idiots, thieves, crooks, and bad people that we'll meet, you can still learn from them.
Yes.
The owner of that Israeli technology company that destroyed his own chance of doing business in China later was indicted in Israel for stealing money. Bad person. But he actually at one point taught me one of the most interesting things in helping me understand how Jewish citizens in Israel feel about Israel that I hadn't heard from anywhere else. He once told me, so if you want to understand how a Jew feels about Israel, going in the desert, which if you've ever been to Israel, it's very easy to do, take your shoes off, your socks off, and walk in the desert for you, and then you will understand. Now, I don't need to agree with his politics. You know what? There's a window of understanding that he gave me that meant something. You can learn from anybody that you speak to. You have to remember that.
I just want you to mention one thing that you made up to me. You told me a story that you first were in Chinese.
You mean the foods?
Yeah, the foods. If you don't mind.
I'll get to that in 1 minute.
Okay.
I'm heading. Okay. One last thing that I think is very important to talk about if you're going to think of doing business in the world. It's one thing to learn a lot online. And what you cannot learn is how you're going to deal with uncomfortable situations and pressures and temptations when you actually presented them in real life situations of war. And I want to talk to you for a moment about how you maintain your integrity in those situations. I think that's very important for young people facing all of the interesting opportunities that they have. And I'm going to be a little blunt on this. I'm going to read what I want to say, but I want to make sure I say it right. You do not need to go to massage parlors. You do not need to drink yourself into a stupor. You do not need to give bribes. You do not need to make payoffs. You do not need to lie. You do not need to cheat. You don't even need to eat food that scares you. Now, other than the food part, and I'll share that as a side, I've never, in all of the years, all of the places that I've done business, I've never had done any of the above, and I've been able to successfully interact and transact business all over the world. And let me tell you, I've been offered all of them, more than once, in many different places. I've always been able to say no very easily. And it hasn't hurt. Your integrity is the most important thing you carry with you every day of your lives, in my view. If you're going to do business anywhere in the world or even here, hold on to that. Nothing is worth more than that. And by the way, even on a particular deal, or if you're working for a company, even if the price of your saying no is a job or a deal, I say then so be it. But integrity is always, always more important. Because that's something you're going to carry with you forever. Sometimes we often all of that and just be a test. Sometimes you may be offered certain things because your host happens to think that's what you expect them to offer you, even if they're not comfortable doing it. It doesn't matter what their motives are. The only thing that matters is how you react to it. And I can tell you, I'm standing here. Despite all the mistakes I may have made in life, I've had a lot of success. I do business all over the world in all different cultures. And I can tell you, you can be successful to whatever extent you wish. You never have to compromise your integrity. It's very, very important. If you remember anything about today, remember that. It helps in those situations to be a little prepared. Plan how to say no if you think something's going to happen. Think it through. Say it with respect, patience, understanding, and show affection to the people and cultures you're dealing with. And I believe, ultimately, you're not going to go wrong. Now, the one exception to that is eating food that scares you. I had it once in the business sense, and once in the personal sense. I'll put it in the business sense. That's actually even better. But the personal sense, when I was dating my wife, she's from Shanghai. First time we went together, I went to meet her family. And I'm the guest of honor. And the meal's in the private room, and the big dolly in the middle. So the first dish comes out, it's put in front of me, and I look at it, and I'm saying, oh, I don't want to touch that. So I try to move it. Everyone keeps moving it back in front of me. And my wife whispers to me, honey, no one's going to take it. No one's going to put it on their plate until you take it. So, okay, I'll just put some on my plate. What's the good deal? So I put some food on my plate. I move it, everyone takes it, and I figure I'm just going to leave it there. Well, everyone's staring at me all the time, and then she says, honey, no one's going to eat anything until you eat something. I have to eat this.
I love it.
So I start eating, and let me tell you, some of the first few things, I went to China thinking I knew what Chinese food was. Because my wife cooked here. We'd go to Chinese restaurants, and I'd get Chinese food that's not on the American translated menu. So I thought, it'll be the same, and it's not. The relationship with food in China is difficult. So I barely eat some of the things on my plate. And as soon as I'm finished, my mother-in-law is saying in Chinese to my wife, he's finished, give him more. Fortunately, it was like 10 or 12 courses, so going to the second courses, again, everything that's coming out, I don't want to touch, and I have this great social pressure. My wife starts to tell me what these are, and I finally said to her, please, it'll be much easier for me. If I don't know what I'm eating, let me just get through this. Okay, by about the fourth course, this is torture for me, I'm having a real hard time. Finally, bowl of soup. And I look at it, it's chicken soup. This is something I'm talking about. I like this. So I put it in front of me in the big bowl, and I take the first ladle, and the foot pops up in the bowl. So I'm saying, you have to keep your faith. Everyone's staring at you. So I said, oh, there's a chicken foot in the bowl. Don't think about it. Take the next ladle, and the head pops up. And I'm saying, oh my God, there's a head. Don't think about it. So I finished taking just the soup. I move it to my wife, and she immediately, with the ladle, starts to kind of like try to push the head underneath other pieces of chicken. So I finally get to turn to her and say, it's okay, I already saw the head, no problem. Now, that was one time I was in a situation where I felt honor-bound to eat what I was uncomfortable eating. It took me about 6 months to really get used to the differences. Now I can eat almost anything. And by the way, now I'm not the guest of honor. So no one cares if I have what I have on my plate or what I take. I like that also. The second time in China, business comes to us. had a client I was trying to attract, that wealthy businessman who came to the U.S. who looked like a bodyguard. He did not discuss business with me for months. Whenever I came, he took me to the fanciest, most expensive restaurants in China. But never talk business. Nothing. Finally, almost 6 months later, he arranged for a private dinner in a room in a hotel. I'm sitting there, and the main course comes out, and I guess the closest description to it is it's a Chinese, this looks like a very large shrimp, it's about this big. It was the most grotesque thing I've ever seen in my life. I have to tell you, if I was alone, I would have gotten up and run out of the room screaming. That was my initial reaction. I couldn't even look at it. It was that horrifying thing. And my wife said, this actually is the most expensive thing you can get in China. This is a great honor. You have to eat it. I said, oh my God, how can I do this? I have to strong act of will. So I spent 6 months trying to get this potential client to go forward with me. So I said, okay, so I picked up the knife and fork, I figured you could just cut it, I won't even look as I'm doing it, and I'll just let you eat it. And I put the fork and I hit like a shell type of thing. So I said, oh my God, I'm gonna have to really pay attention and bend the knife, get it into it and cut it open. It was the most delicious thing I had ever eaten in my entire life.
Thank you.
Interesting. After that meal, the client's assistant came to me and invited me to the client's office the next day. The first time I'd ever been invited there, and the business relationship began that next day. Now, I can tell you, I know today, that was the most delicious food I've ever eaten. I'm putting it in front of you today, I'm not forgetting.
I'm sorry, speaking about the door, I guess some of you can leave, right?
No,
my apologies. Who has to leave? Who wants to stay? Okay. So, if you want to ask, let's give a nice round of applause.